society and civilization, you think about those things. And meanwhile, the guy froze to death in the forest. Like the real life.
All the tech in the world isn't going to save you if you get out into the wild. If you rely on something that has batteries for your sustainment of your life, you're going to be in trouble at some point.
Yeah.
You got to have baseline skills.
Yeah, they say that like when people go into the forest, people are afraid of grizzly bears and all sorts of different things, but hypothermia kills more people than anything.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me. It's slow, too. I mean, that's the insidious onset of, you know, your feet get a little bit cold. And from what I've talked to some guys who work, like, up in Alaska. Right, where's McKinley? I think McKinley's in Alaska, wherever McKinley is. And it's not uncommon for them to find people basically missing, but they're naked. Because it's that slow, the thought process degrades. Oh, I'm sweating and take my jacket off. And then they just lay down and go to sleep. Like, it's just that 1% at a time until you're basically a popsicle.
And doesn't your brain pump morphine or some equivalent to morphine through your body when you're like near death? I think when you're in like severe pain or near death,
your brain literally makes
something.
I think you just go into shock.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know the physical process of what happens when you go into shock, but I've seen some people that are in a lot of pain and they would have liked to have their brain pumping some morphine.
Yeah.
It wasn't happening.
Maybe they weren't pumping enough.
Perhaps.
Yeah. Just I'd read something about that there was someone who was trying to explain near-death experiences and like why when people have near-death experiences, they have all these freaky visions. And some of it they think could be connected to psychedelic chemicals that your brain produces, which are that they definitely know that's true. But I think there was also some talk about some morphine-like substance that your brain makes.
It wouldn't surprise me if your body recognized it was on the downhill slide, that it would be a little
yeah, just, you know, like, look, this dude doesn't need to keep screaming.
Yeah. Probably just a protection mechanism, if anything.
Yeah. Well, when you're out there, man, I think one of the cool things about being in the wilderness is that most people just never experience that for long stretches. And when you do get to experience it, it gives you sort of a, like, oh, I always thought the world was this. I always thought the world was Phoenix, Arizona, where you drive down the street and you go to see your friend and you get in the car and you go to the movies and there's a restaurant. And then you go to Montana, you go wandering through the forest and you see deer and bears and you see the mountains and the quiet and your cell phone doesn't work. And you're like, oh,
yeah,
this is the actual world.
I have found that it's that, and that people, and including myself, think that I am this, and then you go out into that environment where you're detached, and then you have to rely upon yourself and your knowledge and your grit or your fortitude, and you kind of figure out more of who you are as well too. I don't think people really, you don't figure out who you are if you live in the greater Los Angeles area.
Dude. You know who you are in Los Angeles.
Correct. But I don't think who you are in Los Angeles is who you really are.
I don't think so either.
I think you got to go out and outside of that and either rely on yourself or maybe even more importantly, rely on somebody else and have that dynamic outside of a... I mean, you couldn't... Well, I guess you could starve to death, obviously, or, you know, not have enough water. But the places to get those things in L.A., you could solve in a block in either direction.
Yeah.
You go far enough out in the woods and you're on your own. And to me, that's where you find out who you are. I do. I like being out there because I get to think about me a lot.
Yeah, I think that's a real good point, that you're not... who, like, you think you are who you are. You think you know yourself, but you know yourself in the environments that you know.
Correct.
The way you really find out who you are is to experience a lot of different environments and a lot of different difficult things. Like, you don't really know someone until you see them tired, until you see them exhausted.
Hungry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the John Dudley's always said that about hunting. Like, you think you know a guy, take him hunting.
His litmus test is hunting camp.
Yeah.
I believe he says, you'll either be friends for life or I'm never going to want to spend another moment with you.
Yeah.
It's pretty accurate.
Yeah.
See it come off the rails. People are like, oh, I don't want to get up at 5 a.m. I just went to bed at 11. Okay. All right. Well, you're not on the invite list for next year.
You're missing out on this thing we're doing. Yeah.
Hey, you can go hunt that PB&J in the refrigerator.
There's a line where you got to learn, though. Like, there is a line where, like, okay, we could die today. This is not, we should really be careful if we go out today. You know, this is not the right, like, my friend Adam Greentree. Do you know Adam? You got to meet him.
If you don't know. First off, I don't know him, but I definitely follow him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That motherfucker skirts the line. That's his water buffalo up there, by the way, right above Old Glory.
That's awesome. Is that your elk from?
Yeah, that one is. That's from Tejon Ranch.
God, look at the rack on that thing.
But Adam, he crosses that line. He gets to the edge of that line. He
pushes that line is how I would describe it.
He goes out by himself a month at a time, nothing but a tent, runs out of water all the time, drinks funky water coming out. He's got that weird Australian gut, though, where he could just drink water and like...
Get some microbes going on in there.
Whatever he's eaten in his life, it's like it's festering inside of his body. It kills off everything else. He doesn't get sick. The fucking guy drinks out of creeks all the time.
Because he's probably always just sick, and that's his normal.
Maybe.
He is sick.
He's happy, though.
Yeah.
But he gets close. Like, he gets close to that edge. Like that. Did you ever see that? Would you watch the Instagram story when the grizzly bear kept charging him? And he's fucking filming it all for Instagram?
Yeah, but he's also got an unloaded gun. I was very upset with him.
No, it was loaded, but he had never shot it. So
the bullet was out of battery.
No, the bullets were the wrong size for the gun.
So you could barely see the top of the gun. I'm looking at it, and you can see the barrel at the angle. So the slide is back. I'm like, you
can tell.
You're pointing your finger...
At a bear.
You're going to pull on that as it eats your face.
He said the bear ran to 10 yards.
No, thank you.
Full clip, 10 yards.
No. Pass.
False charge, 10 yards. He said when you see it running and you see the muscles rippling under the hair and the hair and the snow and the moisture flying. And imagine
the
breath
and the noise of that claw ripping through the ground. No, thank you.
And it's huge. It's, you know, he said it was like a 9-foot bear. Just running at him.
And obviously he's got a ton of interactions with animals in the wild, but if he had run instead of standing his ground,
he'd have been fucked.
It would have attacked him, right?
100%.
Oh my God.
Yeah, he would have been fucked. You can't, because they just have an instinct. It would just take you out. It's like you're weak, you're moving away. Not only are you not a threat now the bear has the opportunity to close the distance. And the bears don't exactly know what the fuck you are. They don't exactly know what the fuck a person is. They might have seen a person a few times before, but they don't eat a person and they don't fuck a person. The problem is when a bear does eat a person. Once a bear eats a person, like, oh, I could just fucking eat people.
Delicious.
They can't run at all. Like, a bear chases an elk. Like, it's kind of a hustle. It's a lot of running.
I can't imagine a bear catching an elk.
Oh, they catch them.
Do they really?
There's a crazy video of a bear eating a moose. He's chasing this moose, and it's a big fucking bear, and he's chasing him around a circle, and it looks like they're filming it from a helicopter, and the bear is just, this moose is hauling ass. See if you can find that, Jamie. The fucked up thing is, when bears catch you, they just eat you. They don't kill you first.
They
just start eating. Just like they do a salmon, how they grab a salmon and just bite into it and pull it apart. They do that to your guts.
See, that's where I'm really hoping that morphine thing from your brain is true.
Yeah, me too.
Can you imagine looking up and seeing your lower torso inside of the mouth of a massive grizzly bear?
I can imagine it. That's what's so scary. Do you ever see the movie Grizzly Man?
No.
How dare you? How dare you miss out on the greatest unintentional comedy in the history of the world.
I'll watch it tonight.
It's fucking great. You want to talk? We were talking about this before the show, but people who are gay, who don't want to admit they're gay.
Run.
That's this guy. And he decided to go live with the grizzly bears to protect them in the forest.
Oh, he got eaten. I think I know this story.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. But it's a Werner Herzog film.
Okay.
And I don't know if Werner Herzog was trying to make it funny, but... And I mean, maybe it's just funny. It's funny, but it's funny to me because I have this crazy appreciation for wildlife and respect for it. And I there's part of me that like Steve Rinella had a funny way of talking about this guy. He goes, "Hey, say all you want about that guy." He goes, "That guy was a hard camper." He goes, "That guy did some hard fucking camping. He was out there for 6 months at a time." I'm like, yeah, got to give him respect. He really did live with the bears for 6 months at a time, but. Werner Herzog, the way he filmed it, he filmed like the way he would have people talking about the guy. Like they go to a sheriff and the sheriff's like, "I thought he was retarded."
Just really digging into that character and plot development.
Yeah, the guy, I mean, it's just, he shows you this guy's ex-girlfriend who's crazy and they're talking about his life and they interview one of his past roommates or some guy who knew him in LA and he's talking about how crazy he is and how he kind of made up a past for himself and he was just like this really, he had like fake accents that he would use sometimes. He was just a really bizarre character who found his identity in taking care, air quotes, taking care of these bears that didn't need taking care of. And he was going to protect these bears. And, you know, these bears just, they didn't give a fuck about him.
Yeah, I don't think they wanted his protection.
Oh, it was amazing. It's amazing. And but anyway, the film of him getting eaten, he was filming bears, had the cover on the camera, but the audio ran. And the audio ran for 7 minutes. By the way, if you look, you try to find that audio online, it's not there. But there's some fake audio online that people attribute to it. But if you listen to it with a discerning ear, you can tell those people aren't really screaming. It's fake screaming. But it was 7 minutes long of the bear eating him and his girlfriend. His girlfriend hit the bear.
He ate his girlfriend too?
Oh, yeah. The bear was eating him, and the girlfriend hit the bear in the head with a frying pan. It didn't do jack shit. The bear tears her apart.
You know, I'm not going to lie. I'm more surprised that he had a girlfriend.
It wasn't really a girlfriend. It was a girl that was a friend that thought she was girlfriend, a girlfriend.
Two words.
Yeah. I've had friends that are gay that have wives, and these poor wives, they walk around looking like this all day long, like this, like... Like, what the fuck's wrong? How come this guy doesn't fuck me? Like,
oh man,
there's a lot of poor bastards out there that are just deep in the closet, and they don't.
That's not cool.
It's horrible.
Aren't we at that point now where you can just kind of do and be?
I wish we were. Oh, I know a couple guys that are deep in. They don't even say. I talk to them in brief chunks because I get this feeling from them where I'm talking to them where they just want to. End the conversation before I go, hey man, are you gay? Like, it's like every conversation is like this really quick. Hey, good to see you. All right. Hey, take it easy, man.
See you next time.
Hey, hold on. Hey, before you go.
Are you gay?
it's a bummer, man. It's a bummer.
Yeah.
I mean, to get to 2017 and not have that worked out. Seems to me to be a travesty. The fact that people give a shit.
Yeah, why does anybody care? What are their choices that they make in their life?
Well, my theory has been there's two types of people that care about gay marriage, and that is people who are really dumb or people that are secretly worried that dicks are delicious.
I can get behind that campaign.
That's my theory. That was one of my old bits. And I think that when, you know, there's a lot of it that people are afraid that other people are going to think they're gay. A lot of it is people that grew up where they hear terrible things about gay people or prejudice people around them, tell them crazy things about gay people. They don't realize that gay people are just people that like guys. That's it. And there's other guys that like guys too. And if everything was open, they wouldn't feel so creepy. They feel creepy because they have to hide it and be secretive and always be...
Yeah, like it's forbidden or they're... Yeah.
So that's where the weirdness comes from. But if you go to Santa Monica Boulevard, there's this area of like three blocks in West Hollywood and Santa Monica Boulevard that I don't get out of my car. It's not worth it.
You're just loading this scenario up. I'm already thinking in my head, like, I'm never going here.
You ever go to one of those wild animal parks where you stay in your car and the monkeys jump on your car and rip your fucking windshield wipers off?
No.
Yeah. They have those in New Jersey.
What?
I went. Yeah. Yeah, the monkeys jump on your car. I don't know if they have them anymore, but they used to. Well, you used to be there, and you know, you'd have to like agree that the monkey might fuck your car up.
You can sign a waiver when you go in.
Like, don't go there with a Ferrari. Don't go there with a car that could get jacked because these monkeys might jack your car. But you would be around these animals, and you'd stay in your vehicle the entire time. They have one in China, and it's a great story. About a year ago, this lady was in an argument with her boyfriend. She's like, fuck you. And she got out of the car, and she went around the car, and she was yelling at him, and a fucking tiger came.
You posted that video. I saw that.
Yeah. Oof. And just yanked her away. And then someone else chased after her, and apparently she lived, but her mom died. Her mom was
trying to save her?
Yeah, save her from the tiger, and the tiger killed her mom. This dumb bitch. Just thought she's like, I have it in my head. I'm going to fucking say what I want, and I'm going to get out of this car. Fuck you. And she gets out of her car, and she does it in a wild animal park filled with 800-pound tigers.
If you do stupid things, you're going to win stupid prizes.
It's amazing how quick the tiger seizes the opportunity, though.
I remember from that video, she was only on the driver's side of the car for a few seconds, and then it was lights out.
Pull that up.
It's a great video to watch. It's
one of my favorite videos of all time. It's just like, I don't want anybody to get killed by a tiger. I really don't. But I do want, if someone gets killed by a tiger doing something really fucking stupid, I do want everybody to watch that and go, hey.
Don't do that.
This ain't the Lion King, motherfucker. This shit's real. Look at, here it is.
Oh God.
She gets out of the car in the Wildlife Zoo. She gets out. Watch. Passenger side, backseat. Fuck you.
Just imagine the argument going on.
Oh, it's front seat.
I'm out of here.
Yeah. She's like, I'm so tired of bullshit. She runs around to the other side.
She's gonna make one more point.
And the guy's like, hey, will you just fucking relax, bitch? Just don't hit me. Don't hit me. God damn it. Get back in your car. Get back. Jesus.
Oh, God damn it.
Just drags her away. And he runs out of the car. Oh God. And then the mom runs out and that lady's dead. The third lady's dead. And as the Rangers come out, they're gonna try to save her.
See, I think the move is close all doors, roll up windows.
That thing grabs her so quick. It's like, this is what I've wanted. I'm so tired of eating cold meat served on an aluminum tray. Fuck you. Fuck you for keeping me here. I think, here's the thing, man. I think if they fed those tigers wild animals, they probably wouldn't do that. They probably wouldn't give a shit about that lady. But what they do is they give the tigers no animal reward. They have an animal reward system, right? Mm-hmm. The tiger's job is to clean up the population. Oh, there's one, this tiger flying through the fucking air.
Oh, this dude. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, ripped this guy's hand apart. It just flew up to the top of an
elephant. Is he missing some fingers?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's what I'm talking about.
Ripped his hand apart. Yeah, tigers don't play. But if you let that tiger kill things, like if they let a bunch of axis deer loose, which
it'll satiate that demand.
Yeah, that would be what they look for. They would chase down the deer, eat them. They'd live like natural. But so they have this overwhelming desire. It's like, here's a way to put it. If you, yeah, if like if you were a guy, that's not a good way to put it. I was going to say if you're a guy and they extracted all the cum from your balls, but they kept you horny, but that doesn't make sense.
that makes absolutely no sense.
Yeah, I bailed on it right when I was like, that's a bad analogy, dude. Don't run with that one. But these animals, they get their appetite satisfied, but not their appetite to kill. They're born, yeah, like you roll a ball of yarn in front of a kitten, fucking cat dives on it. Because that's what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to attack things. They have a built, even little fluffy little kittens, they have a built-in desire to attack things.
I think that's why people are the way they are on social media. They don't have the release that the human body, soul, spirit, however you want to describe it, is designed to get somewhere else. And if all you get it from is a device through other people's pictures or selective posts, I think you go crazy inside. I think that is why I don't trust nearly every human being on the face of the planet. It's just they're not, I don't think they get the chance to express who they want to be.
I agree 100%. I agree 100%. And I think I've been thinking a lot about this whole boss, employee, sexual assault, sexual harassment thing that's been going on.
Yeah, every day, like something else comes out on that.
And it's always the same thing. It's always a man in power and a woman who works for him and something goes down. And it's never the opposite. It's never chicks getting their pussy eaten by some dude who works in the office. It's never. There's a lot of women that are CEOs.
Or it hasn't been reported yet.
Those guys can keep their mouth shut, right?
Or the guy doesn't consider that to be harassment.
It's not. She lets you fuck her and she buys you a car? Damn, dude, you got a Mustang. The fuck are you going to the New York Post for?